Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to our Holy Communion service this morning. And it's lovely to see the sun shining, and if you hear any noises that appear to be on a roof, it's not very heavy rats or four-footed furry creatures. It's workmen that we are delighted to see who are working on the roof in the hall. So we are really pleased that they're taking every opportunity when it is dry to get our building back to usable and wind and watertight. So we're grateful to them. It says, to Reverend Matthias and members of St. Leonard's Church, I write to express my profound gratitude for the beautiful card containing a most kind and thoughtful message for that you sent me in celebration of my 95th birthday. I am delighted to learn that St. Leonard's is continuing to make a remarkable contribution to Christian witness in the city. Yours sincerely, Robert Burton. So there's a card that we can put on the notice board. So it is nice to see that our Christian witness is appreciated in the city. I have to remember that Dunfermline is a city. So let's stand and sing our invocation. If you believe. Jesus is the one we follow. He came to serve. He humbled himself on a cross, and he was and is exalted. Jesus is our pattern and example. He is our teacher, and we are all his students. So let's join together in worshiping him. Let's sing our first hymn this morning from CH4, 124. Praise the Lord, the Almighty King of creation.
Thank you.
How are you this morning? Good. You're all wrapped up there. That's a lovely coat you've got. Beautiful fur hood. Is it cozy? Yeah. Oh, it's got a fur lining too. How lucky are you? What is the luckiest thing about it? It's got a belt. Wow. I wish I had a coat like that. It's got pockets. And they've got zips. And does that stop you losing things? Because you can zip them in your pockets. That's really good because, you see, quite often I bend over and the microphone thing will fall out of there. It wouldn't fall out if I had zipped pockets, would it? So today, we're thinking about, you want to come out here? And then you see, everybody can see that nice coat of yours. Coming out here. I wonder if we could do some things together. So if I asked you to do something, will you do it? Yeah, okay. So it's a bit like Simon says. So if Simon says, let's see, what will we do? Stamp our feet. That's it. Well done. Because I didn't stamp my feet, did I? I clapped my hands. So I did it wrong, didn't I? Right, what else can we do? What about touch your nose? Yeah, because I got it right then. Do you know this? Sometimes people can be too smart, can't they? Right, Simon says, we better play this game right or I'm going to be in big trouble. What about, Simon says, pat your head. Yeah, you see, you did it. Right, what about another one? Let's think. What about, Simon says, touch your toes. I'm not touching my toes. That might be a bit hard for me to touch my toes because I'm old. But you see, what else can we do? What about, Simon says, run to the end of the corridor, run to that table there and run all the way back. You see, you're very good at following instructions, but the story in the Bible today was about Jesus speaking to the Pharisees and the scribes. So these were people who taught other people in the church, and they were very good at telling people to do things, but they didn't do them themselves. Does that sound familiar? I think we can all do that, can't we? We can all do things. We can say we do things, and then we know what we should be doing, but we don't do it. Like, I can't, well, maybe I could touch my toes, but I'm not going to do it. But it's easy to say what to do, but sometimes it's more difficult to follow it through. But what Jesus wants us to be like is that we do what is right. And so if we're saying that we should, you know, if we're teaching things that we should be doing, then we should all be doing them. And it's about being humble and a bit of humility in all that we say and we do. Because we all make mistakes and we can correct our mistakes. Nobody is perfect. But it's doing what God wants us to do that is what counts. So we're going to have a wee song called The Butterfly Song. Will that be okay? Well, we'll have the butterfly.
For making you special.
Aw, there's nothing special about me.
Who said that?
Me, boring little me.
Do you know Jesus?
Yeah.
Well, do you have Jesus living in your heart?
Uh-huh.
Well, then you're special. You're God's special child.
I am?
You are.
I am?
You are.
I am. I'm God's special child. I'm special.
And don't you forget it. Now, how about singing this song?
Yeah, let's sing. Can I start?
Sure, be my guest.
powered by raising my trunk. And if I were a kangaroo, I'd just hop right up to you. And if I were an octopus, I'd thank you, Lord, for my good looks.
But I just thank you, Father, for making me, me. 'Cause you
us up this morning, isn't it? Just to remind us that we've to smile and be happy, and Jesus made us all. So I think Jessica's going through the hall, so let's have a wee prayer before you go through, Jessica. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for Jessica, for all our young folk, for our teachers, and as Jessica goes through to learn more about you and play in the hall, we just give thanks for her. And be with her. Bless her and the teachers this morning and all that they do in sharing your love together through play. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So go and have some fun. Let's draw near to God in prayer. Let's pray. All-powerful, all-seeing God, you are our role model in life. Father, you beckon us into your kingdom glory, where there is no room for self as all hearts overflow with your love. Lord Jesus, our Saviour, you are the light that shines without blemish. Holy Spirit, full of wisdom, your kingdom integrity is our guide. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we worship and adore you. When we close our hearts to those most needing your love, when we close our minds to helping others, when we keep our arms locked by our side instead of reaching out, God of love, forgive us. When we shut our ears to the voices of the vulnerable, when we remain silent in the face of injustice, when we look the other way, preferring not to get involved. God of love, forgive us. Open our hearts, open our minds, open our arms, and help us walk your way. And now let us join together in prayer by saying the prayer Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so now I'm going to ask Sheila to come up and read our gospel reading. Thanks.
Good morning. Our reading this morning will be from Matthew chapter 23, 1 to 12. And that is seven woes. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, so you must obey them and do everything they tell you. But do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy loads and put them on men's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for men to see. They make their phylacteries and their tassels on the garments long. They love the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogues. They love to be greeted in the marketplaces and to have men call them rabbi. But you're not to be called rabbi, for you have only one master, and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father, and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called teacher, for you have one teacher, the Christ. The greatest among you will be your servant. For whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." Amen, and may God add his blessing to this reading of his word.
Thank you, Sheila, for reading God's word. And we're going to join together and sing once more from CH4, hymn 513, "Courage, Brother, Do Not Stumble."
Thank you.
The Greek word hypocrite means deceiver, and its full meaning is to make you think that you have a, to make people think you have a particular feeling or attitude. It's like pretending to be something you are not. And one of the interesting things about Jesus' words are found in verse 3. So you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. In the verses that follow, Jesus condemns the practices, but not the teachings of the scribes and Pharisees. The three criticisms levelled upon the scribes and the Pharisees by Jesus are: they say but do not do, they burden others while failing to act, and they act for the wrong reason, to make good impressions on others. What exactly are we to do as followers of Christ? Jesus gives us the answer to the question in verses 11 and 12. The greatest among you will be your servant. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and for those who humble themselves will be exalted. As a disciple of Jesus, we must be willing to be a servant. When we look into the Greek for the word translated as servant, we find the word diakonos, which means to help, to serve, to be a deacon. And it's where we get our diaconate from, and our deacons that work in the church. So these translations joined together in this content point to the fact that our influence is measured by our willingness to serve others. God is not interested in how great we are, but how willing we are to serve others. And so I thought I've put together a few slides of some famous people who were all ordinary people, but have achieved extraordinary things. The first one is actually just to say the words, a change of thought. I can't read it from here. That's right, a change is brought about because of ordinary people doing extraordinary things. And so, we'll have our next slide, please. Anybody know who that is? It's Baden-Powell, yes, visionary for the Girl Guides. And so, you know, she was a younger sister, well, it says it's Agnes Baden-Powell, founder of, she helped establish the Girl Guide Association in the United Kingdom in 1910 after a group of girls attended the first Boy Scout rally, calling themselves Girl Scouts. And look at where we are today with the Girl Guides, you know, just through, you know, somebody, people having the vision, ordinary people, and they have a vision to do something that lasts for a long, long time and has a profound effect on other people. The next slide. An American lady. Rosa Parks. So Rosa Parks was tired from a full day's work, and she boarded the Montgomery bus on December the 1st, 1955, and forever became one of the inspirational people because she refused to give up her seat when the driver told her to go and sit at the back of the bus so that a white person could sit. And she was arrested for civil disobedience. And due to her defiance, there was a Montgomery bus boycott. And what followed then started the civil rights movement. Slide 4, please. Tiananmen Square, yes. The man who, it's entitled here, Tank Man, who faced down the Chinese army. And can you imagine the courage that that must have taken to stand in front of all those tanks? So we've all seen that powerful image of the man. He was never identified, and the photo was taken on June the 6th, 1989, the day after China cracked down on student protesters. And despite his anonymity, Tank Man has become an internationally recognised symbol of resistance to government oppression. Next slide, please. Yeah, Malala. And I'm not pronouncing her surname. It's like Yousafzai, but I can't pronounce it. But anyway, she stood up for better education for women. She was born in Pakistan, learned early on the importance of education from her father, who was a teacher at a girls' school. And when the Taliban took control of her town in 2008, they prohibited girls from going to school. She publicly spoke out against it and was shot on the left side of her head for standing up for what she believed in. After months of recovery and moving to the United Kingdom with her family, she refused to hide her fear, instead using her voice to start the Malala Fund, a charity dedicated to ensuring every girl has the opportunity to go to school. At 17, she became the youngest person to ever receive the Nobel Peace Prize. And I'm sure she would never have thought she would have reached such fame. The next one. This one might be a bit more obscure. It's a lady from America called Lois Gibbs, and she was protecting families from toxic waste. And this is in the 1970s. She was a housewife in Niagara Falls, New York, and her two children had a very rare illness. In fact, almost all the neighbours in what is now called the Love Canal neighbourhood faced serious medical problems after learning that they live next to 20,000 tonnes of toxic chemicals and that no organisation existed to address this problem. She founded the Citizens Clearinghouse for Hazardous Waste, now known as the Centre for Health, Environment and Justice. And thanks to her, more than 800 families were evacuated and the clean-up of the Love Canal began. So if it weren't for Gibbs, there would be no US Environmental Protection Agency Superfund to clean toxic sites around the country. And my last slide, please. He's a sir. He's Sir Tim Berners-Lee, creator of the World Wide Web. You're only able to read this article to find the development of the World Wide Web in 1994 at MIT's Laboratory for Computer Science. But whom do we have to thank for that? This man, an average British computer scientist. In the late 1980s, he proposed a project that combined hypertext, the system that allows you to click on links and open other web pages, and the internet. His goal was to allow researchers a place to share information online so that others could see it at any time of the day. The end result was the World Wide Web we know and rely on today. He was knighted by Queen Elizabeth II in 2004. So these were ordinary people who did extraordinary things. They probably didn't aim to do extraordinary things. They were doing some of it, probably doing what they enjoyed doing, maybe, you know, like the scientists, others thrown into it through circumstances. But people can do extraordinary things. And this brings us home to Scotland with the story which was included in the order of service from the Roots material. Reflect for a few moments on a Scottish missionary. Not Columba, Ninian, or any other famous Celtic saint. This story is about a girl who lived within recent memory. During a missionary talk in Glasgow, she felt God's call. A life-changing moment, and it led to what she described as her life work, and ultimately to the sacrifice of her life in Auschwitz. This missionary is Jane Haining, and she was born in 1897, a strong Christian family in a peaceful rural idyll in Dumfriesshire. Outstanding achievements at school led to a successful working life in Glasgow, which is how she came to be there in 1927, to hear God calling her. She retrained and devoted the rest of her life to caring for young girls in the Scottish missionary school in Budapest. During a visit home in 1939, with war imminent, Jane was not persuaded to remain safe in Scotland. Her memorial in her birthplace records her response: "If these children need me in the days of sunshine, how much more will they need me in the days of darkness?" She returned to her duties, but was soon arrested by the Gestapo and accompanied some of her children to Auschwitz, where she perished. Some school pupils survived the death camp and remembered her commitment, dedication and care for the rest of their lives. Eventually, in 1997, on the 52nd anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz, Jane Haining was recognised on the Wall of Honour in the Garden of Remembrance in Yad Vashem, Jerusalem, as one of the righteous among the nations, an award given to non-Jews who risked their lives to save Jews during the Holocaust, which began as an ordinary Scottish life, will now forever be remembered for her faithfulness to Jesus, own ministry and sacrifice as a servant of humankind. Of course, Jane Haining is not the only one. There are many whose lives are an example and an inspiration to others, to us. Some may be well known or even famous, like some of the people we've shown this morning. But either during or after their lifetime, when fame they're renowned for their fame. But many, if not most, will be ordinary people called by God not to seek honour or glory, but to serve in the place they were called to be. Ordinary people like us. This may seem daunting, but God knows what we are capable of and may be asking us to come out of our comfort zone. Let us be willing to let God work within us in humility. Humility isn't something we do. It is the attitude with which we live our lives. Humility means our dependence on God that results in trusting and obeying God. And I'm going to finish with a story which I think paints a valid picture of how we approach humility. A mother was preparing pancakes for her two sons, and the boys began to argue over who would get the first pancake. Their mother saw the opportunity for a moral lesson, and she said, "If Jesus were sitting here, he would say, 'Let my brother have the first pancake. I can wait.'" The older son turned to his younger brother and said, "You be Jesus." Do we think of humility as being humble like the older brother by others showing humility instead of adopting that stance ourselves? So, on that bit of humour, as we prepare to share Holy Communion together, let us give ourselves humbly and wholeheartedly to God and to his service. And we're going to sing together again from CH4, hymn 532 from CH4. "Lord, you have come to the seashore." Let's join together in prayer once more with our offering prayer and prayers for the world. Loving God, we bless you again for your generosity to us. We ask your blessing on our lives and on the way we use your gifts of money, time, and skills as we seek to follow Jesus and to show the world his love today and every day. Loving God, creator of the world, we bring your world before you, a world in turmoil, a world battling against itself, a world in which we see evil rampaging. And we pray for your hand on Israel and Gaza and all nations involved in conflict. We pray safety for hostages and comfort for their families. We pray for children left orphaned, for all those suddenly bereaved, and for all who are displaced and have no refuge. Loving God, November the 5th, in this country, sees fireworks colouring the sky, the smell of bonfire smoke mingling the air. But we pray for all those today living amid the real fear of airstrikes, of enemy explosives lightening the sky and bringing devastation. We pray for those caught up amid the destruction, choking in the dust-filled air. And we pray for all people experiencing heartbreak and hunger. Loving God, bring peace, hope, and reconciliation. May all look to you and the safe comfort of your arms. Loving God, we pray for the unrest in this country, fueled by the war in the Middle East. We pray for those targeted. We pray for your Holy Spirit to speak into the hearts of the perpetrators. Almighty God, change hearts. Give wisdom to the government to dilute and deal with the growing situation. Move hearts, Lord. Bring calm to our streets. Loving God, we bring before you all people who work in the mission field, and we pray for all who have gone before, spreading your word of truth, bringing your love in practical ways, with all those you call today to walk your path. Almighty God, we pray for safety around all those who walk in dark places. Keep from harm all who go into danger zones to offer practical aid in your name and bring salvation. Loving God, we bring before you all who work and reach out to the less fortunate. We pray for those people whose homes and businesses were flooded during the recent storm and who live with the dread of further rainfall. We bring our local communities to you, and in a time of silent prayer, we offer those that we know are in need of prayer to you this morning. Loving God, be with the lost, the lonely, the vulnerable, the suffering. Help us to be good neighbours, to shine your light in dark places, and be authentic witnesses to those you place in our lives. Lord Jesus, hear our prayer. Amen. And so as we join together to celebrate Holy Communion, we'll sing from CH4, number 566, When I Receive the Peace of Christ.
I receive the peace.
We are invited to gather around this table. This is the Lord's table, and we are invited guests to share this joyful feast. So accept his invitation and feel welcome at this table. Jesus Christ, who here offers us a foretaste of eternal life, invites us to be his guests. Hear the words of the institution of the Lord's Supper according to St. Paul. The tradition which I handed on to you came to me from the Lord himself, that on the night of his arrest, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." So we will do as Jesus did. We will take this bread and this wine, the produce of the earth and the work of human hands, through which Jesus has promised to make himself known. And as he said a prayer before sharing, let us follow his example. Let's join together in prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, for you are the one from whom we came and the one to whom we will return. You conceived the universe, wove the world together, and hold all life in your hand. You watch us, waking or sleeping. You keep every tear that we shed. You hear every prayer we make. You know both our best and our worst, and you will not let us go. So with rain, wind, and sunshine, with all that moves in time with its maker, we praise you. With angels and archangels, with the saints of long ago, with our loved ones who are gathered round your heavenly table, we praise you. With the church throughout the world, with all who love Jesus and honour his name, we praise you, singing the hymn of your everlasting glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. As we do what Jesus once did, let your spirit move among us to settle on this bread and this wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of Christ. And let that same spirit stir our souls so that as we share this sacrament, we may recognize our Lord and receive him, that he may be in us and we in him forever. Amen. According to the holy institution, example, and command of our Lord Jesus Christ, and as a memorial of him, we do this. When on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do it in memory of me." Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the worlds, grant us peace. And so let us now share communion together. Draw near in faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood, which was shed for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who find refuge in him. Take, eat. This is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. Do this, remembering him. This cup is the new covenant and sealed by Christ's blood, which was shed that the sins of many might be forgiven. Drink from it, all of you. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. So let's take a moment just to share the peace with those that are near us.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Let's join together in prayer once more. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the love which brings us as food from heaven, the life of your dear Son, and assures us that we belong to the company of all his faithful people in heaven and on earth. Grant that, strengthened by this fellowship and by the power of his Holy Spirit, we may continue his work in the world until we come to the glory of your eternal kingdom, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. So we're going to sing our closing hymn, which I'm not sure if people know. So Nancy's going to play it through once for us before we sing it. It's from CH4 674, Hallelujah, We Sing Your Praises. So we're going to attempt this. Go now, children of the living God. You are loved as you are. Go now and walk in the way of God. Take peace with you and walk humbly. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore.